My name is Jan Brandjes, and I'll be talking today a little bit about insulating a house, the way to do it right, and maybe also show you the way you can do it wrong. Australia never has been very detailed on insulating houses. We have not a really descriptive thing in the building code to talk about how things need to be done. While you go overseas in Europe and North America, it's a very detailed type of documentation that you need to follow. Instructions are there. So I thought it'd be a good idea today to just talk a little bit about how insulation should be installed. Of course, when you do an investment in insulation, you're buying a product for a couple of $1,000 to create a thermal building envelope. And that thermal building envelope is crucially important to getting comfort in your house and low energy bills. So let's talk a little bit more about the building envelope technology. Yeah, building envelope technology, it's a word that's not well understood often in Australian construction, but basically you have to see the building envelope as the skin on a body. It protects you against cold, it protects you against rain, against noise, against dust and all the other things. So what it is called the building envelope is basically the barriers that you create between the outside and the inside. For instance, if you have lots of insulation and a well-sealed building, you will make sure that the energy stays in the house, you keep the heat out in the summertime and the cold out in the winter. And at the same time, because the building is nice, well-sealed and well-insulated, you have low energy bills at the same time. So there's a lot of benefits for that. Now, interestingly enough, people often don't see what happens in the building envelope and therefore it gets ignored. For instance, in new construction, often it's about what the house looks like, how it looks on the outside, how it's presented, how the kitchen is put together, what kind of flooring goes on, what kind of paint goes on. But the things that actually are hidden away from plain sight is what is in the building envelope. Now, building envelope, to keep it very simple, is the floor that we stand on, it's the walls, and it's the ceiling. So that's basically the area that we need to create a nice, comfortable, the building envelope is the area that keeps us warm in the winter time and cool in the summer. So what I want to show you today is how to insulate a house properly, because insulation, although we have a standard, we say it must have, let's say, an R1.5 or an R2 in the walls to comply with the energy rating that we have here in Victoria. But the real kicker is that we want to make sure that it's placed correctly, because if we leave gaps in the insulation in the building, we don't seal it completely, we don't have a continuous air barrier, basically we're wasting money. If you forget 5% of your wall area or your ceiling area in insulation, you lose roughly 50% of the value. If you translate it in money, if you spend $3,000 on insulation, you basically get $1,500 worth of investment back. So it's very important to do things the right way. I'm going to show you how the insulation is installed properly, and basically what it comes down to, no gaps, no compression, and make sure that everything is nice and well sealed. Okay, first of all, there are many different types of insulation out there. The most common ones would be the fiberglass, as you know, the stuff that itches. We would have polyester beds, we can use spray foam insulation in walls, we can have fixed kind of insulation, you know, the panels that go in, you have types of foil board. So there's a wide range of insulation products out there. Then the next step is you need to be aware how much insulation needs to go in a wall. And also in the ceiling. And the reason of that is that we have an energy rating, and in the energy rating, in order for you to get that 5 or 6 or 7 star, it will say you must have this amount of insulation in the wall. Now, for the purpose of the wall here, this is a 2x4 wall. You can put anywhere between 1.5 beds to R2 beds in there, and with me I have an R1.5 bed. It happens to be a polyester bed. Here, I can show you it here. This is a polyester bed, very simple to use. The beauty of it is it doesn't itch, so it goes in quite easy. Now, from practice, what I always recommend is you wear a pair of gloves, You wear a pair of glasses. You don't need a hard hat per se for that. Okay, let's start here. We have a bed. This is our opening. You can see on this side is the moisture barrier between the inside and the outside. When the bed goes in, you want to make sure that it fits in there nicely. Now, I put my finger here, right where the noggin is, and then I'll just very simply go. And you see with the polyester bed, it's very simple to cut. And you put the bed in. Don't squash it. Make sure that it fits completely in there. There. Now, I just want to show you, because on purposely I cut it a bit short. So in this case, you have an opening there. That's the gap we want to get rid of. So what I do is actually cut or strip another bit of insulation out there. Put this away. And I tuck it in there. There. There we go. And that's how you put insulation in. Now, I'll show you often what happens with insulating. If it goes in and I put another bed in there, it gets put in very quickly, very roughly, and it goes like this, and they say we're done. Now, this type of a gap is just crucial. This will let a lot of energy out of the building. You always want to make sure that it's nice and tight. So, there you go. See, it's a very simple process. As they say in construction, the devil is in the detail. It's a very small thing to do, it's very simple to do, and it makes a big difference over the whole building. So these are some of the areas that you need to be aware of. Now, sometimes you find that the opening cavity in the between the studs is too narrow. So you have to then decide, how do I get it in? Compressing the insulation in, as it's squashing it in, is not a good thing, because insulation works best when it's the air that's inside the bed is not squashed out. It's actually the air inside the bed that gives you the insulation. So what you should do here is measure up the width and gently get the insulation in. Here, I'll show you another one on top. And again there. Now, keep in mind that there are no gaps between the two beds here. See, and very simple, you can fill up the cavity. This is a 1.5 bed. You can go higher, you can go to another 2. Now, in this particular type of construction, what you find is you get a steel frame here, a post, and a steel here, and that is supporting a steel structure above it. So, of course, we cannot put insulation in here. So, what you should consider in the construction process is actually see if you can put on the outside of the steel post some foil board or some type of insulation that creates a thermal barrier between the outside and the inside. So this actually needs to be done before the brickwork or any kind of cladding gets placed on the outside of the building. Another point is here, you see this cavity between the actual window frame and the stud. It's always good before the architrave goes up, before the plaster goes up, to fill this spot up with either an insulation product or a expandable foam product. There are what I call foam rods out there that are available in the industry that you can put in here. Two functions: A, it gives you a bit of thermal, so a bit of insulation in between, but it also stops any kind of air movement to go between the outside and the inside of the house. So those are important things, okay? All right, now, another point that we see often these days in construction is the use of steel beams, I-beams, that are used in timber frame construction just to give support to a level above or whatever. That's a cavity that must be insulated. That's important. So it's not like, oh, we don't have to do it because it's not part of the timber frame. It always must be insulated. So always look around and say, how can we insulate that area? And sometimes it's a bit more difficult to do, but just take the time. If you think that a bed might fall out during insulation, then consider using an insulation foam sheeting, cut it to size and mount it into the I-beam, and that will give it the proper thermal protection. It's steel. We actually can reach that quite easily because it's a low window. So here you can say, okay, how can I insulate that? Well, the best way to do is actually measure again the distance between and there. Just give you an example. This is how you start insulating. Don't say, oh, I'm just squashing it down here, but just take your time and say, okay, I'm gonna fill it in. There's always plenty of offcuts in insulation. So there. And then you can say, okay, I'll just gonna fill the cavity up with some more insulation. Even those little spots here. We just like to make sure that you don't have any opening sitting there. There you go. And that gives it a bit of thermal protection. Important part. The building code actually specifies that we have what I call a continuous insulation barrier for the whole house. Continuous means it must continue. So if you look at the top, you have to insulate also there where the rim joist runs, in the spot that you think it's hard to reach because there is something above it. You must be able to insulate it properly. Now, there's another thing. Of course, in walls, we always have plumbing lines. We got electrical wiring. We got all kinds of things running there that are in the way. So here's a good example of that. Obviously, we're here in the kitchen area. You never try to squash your bed in front of your plumbing. You actually, what you do is you split the bed in half. See how I split it in half? Where then one section goes behind the plumbing and one section goes up front. You achieve with that there is no compression of the insulation. It can sit there quite nicely. I'll just give you a bit of an example here with a bit of bed that we have. I'm just going to split the bed in two. Here. Now what we do is we actually get the insulation to go behind, and then the rest of the insulation goes up front. Sometimes it's hard to keep it in place. If it falls out, you can actually use a bit of a staple and staple it to the side of the stud if you like. But you see here, now the plumbing is tucked away between two layers of insulation. When you start insulating, it usually happens once the plumber is finished with the roughing and the electrician is done with the roughing. You start to insulate the cavity of the frame, but then you get into a corner where an internal wall meets an external wall. Now, this stud is designed to pick up the plaster here, this stud is designed to pick up the plaster here. You never be able to insulate anymore in this cavity, because on the other side there's already brickwork. So we have a thermal break in our insulation. The smart thing to do is during the framing, look at where you have walls meet and where you only get access from the outside. Put insulation in from the outside during the framing stage. So those areas where we have the junctions and corners of buildings where it's not insulated, that should be done during the framing stage. Thank you.